thank the law school and the sponsors of the conference for arranging and inviting us here today. The topic of our panel is practice before the Patent Trial and Appeal Board and IPRs and CBMs. We'll tease you a little bit about the more detailed panels that will follow to whet your interest. And without further ado, let me introduce our panelists. Judge Chen is an administrative patent judge with the Patent Trial and Appeal Board. He's been in intellectual property law practice since the 1980s. Some of the leading technology law firms, a partner at Latham & Watkins, McDermott, Will & Emery, and Wilson Sonsini, and also experience in industry as general counsel of Linear Technology. To Judge Chen's left is Steve Baughman. He's a partner at Ropes & Gray in Washington, D.C., recently returning from founding their Tokyo office. He chairs the firm's post-grant patent office practice and also is active in litigation. Further down the panel is David O'Brien. He's a partner at Haynes and Boone's in Austin. His practice focuses on trials before the Patent Trial and Appeal Board, patent portfolio development, and counseling. Next down the panel is Dr. Rose Thiessen. She's a partner at Knobbe Martens in San Diego and in Silicon Valley. Her practice focuses on patent prosecution and licensing. Dr. Thiessen has a PhD in chemistry and works with chemical, pharmaceutical, and medical device companies. And at the far end of the panel, Lee Van Pelt, one of the founders of Van Pelt, Egan James, intellectual property law firm that, if you're from out of town, is a fixture in the Silicon Valley law and technology community. He's broadly worked with the strategy, business, and patent protection for technology companies in the Valley for a number of years. So we're going to be talking about a number of topics related to the practice before the Patent Trial and Appeal Board. Let me start off with a question for the practitioners about what considerations go into the choice of challenging validity of a patent in the Patent Trial and Appeal Board. Client walks into your office, they say there's a troublesome patent, maybe it's in litigation or not. What do you think about and what do you consider in choosing one form or the other? Steve, why don't we start with you?
Sure, I'll start off, and again, thanks for the opportunity to talk with you all this morning. I think the first thing you think about is how the new mechanisms that we've heard a lot about this morning already, these are really game-changing additions to the arsenal. So how might they fit into an overall strategy that makes sense for a particular case? So I think it's been said before, not every case makes sense for a PTAB proceeding, but there may well be aspects of a case that do lend themselves to that, to the idea of getting an independent decision maker for some issues and separating out what arguments you're going to make in which forum can be really valuable. So I think assessing what matters in your case, whether you have strong invalidity issues as well as non-infringement issues, you want to get even consideration to both of those, and that might be hard in some forums, in some district courts in particular. You don't have a lot of time before a jury. Is that something you want to take out and separate and place before a really experienced panel of judges who are going to give invalidity as much consideration as every other aspect of the case? So I think in particular where you might be eligible for a CBM review, covered business method review, that has added the traction of reducing the estoppel consequences and letting you choose more carefully which issues you wish to raise in which forum. And I think that combined with the idea in a place like the Eastern District of Texas of being able to trifurcate your case, think about being in Texas and being able to take the issue you want to talk about as a defendant, invalidity, and do nothing but that for a while, not taking discovery on infringement or damages, not having your personnel deposed and disrupting your business, not having the shift of risk, the sort of litigation cost that drives so much settlement in a lot of PAE cases, and particularly in the Eastern District. I think if those are factors, they help you see what is possible using this new mechanism, and to borrow on what Ken and Dennis and others were saying this morning, you know, these post-grant proceedings are not your grandfather's re-exam, and they really do add new options that are different from each other, and I know the rest of the panel will talk also about how to choose among them, but I think for my money, CBM, where it's available, has some advantages over IPR and certainly PGR that make it worth considering in particular.
Judge Chen, let me ask you, from your perspective, what type of cases are the Patent Trial and Appeal Board the right forum for?
Well, thank you, and before I get to that, you asked me about my perspective. Let me give you the 30,000-foot perspective. So I am an administrative patent judge, and how did I get to be an APJ here in Silicon Valley? Well, we are part of the executive branch of our government, and there's something called the Department of Commerce. And then within the Department of Commerce, there is an agency, the United States Patent and Trademark Office. Within that agency is the Patent Trial and Appeal Board, which currently numbers about 230 administrative patent judges, of which 20 or so of us are resident in our Silicon Valley facility, currently in Menlo Park, and soon to be in San Jose. Let me take a moment to please ask the director of our Silicon Valley Patent Office, John Kabeka, who's here in attendance. John is over there, and for the few of you who have probably not met John, I would absolutely encourage you to do so. He has an energy and enthusiasm for the agency and for the principles of innovation that I think you'd sense within moments of meeting him. So he's been out here about a year and replaced Michelle Lee, who's now, as you all know, the head of the PTO. So John, I urge all of you to take the time to get to know him, because as we move to San Jose in our permanent facility later this year, it promises to really be a centerpiece for the PTO here on the West Coast. Now, the next thing I'll do before I get to the perspective, and I apologize if this was done earlier, I came in a little late, given the audience, and I've done this before, and it's worked pretty well. But given where we are, I'd just like a show of hands on who we are, because I think that will help me with my remarks. How many here are law students? Anybody? Great. Anybody thinking about going to law school? Okay. Fantastic. Excellent. The most important part of the audience. Any law professors here? All right, excellent. How about practicing attorneys? Okay, of those of you in practice, how many are in private practice currently? And of those of you in private practice, how many represent patent owners? Accused infringers? Both. Okay, how many of you work inside companies? Startups? Public companies? Life science, technology. How many have had experience litigating patent disputes in the district courts? International Trade Commission? And how about at the PTAB? Well, great. So that's a great and wide range of experience that all of you bring, and that helps my perspective, because the question put to me is, what is my perspective on an AIA trial? And that's what I see. That's what I've been seeing. I've seen petitioners who are small entities. I've seen petitioners that are some of the world's largest technology companies. I've seen patent owners who are individuals. I've seen patent owners who are among the world's largest technology companies, and my colleagues who are involved in the AIA trials involving life sciences companies have seen some of the world's largest pharmaceutical companies. So what we have is a full range of litigants, a full range of counsel at firms numbering the Am Law 100 down to some smaller patent boutique firms. So for those of us who are APJs, any matter that comes in the door could include backgrounds such as we've seen. But all of them share a common thread, and that is we view the PTAB as another forum for resolution of a patent dispute. And as has been commented on this morning already, people were very used to litigating in the district court or at the ITC, and we are something a little bit new and different, and the popularity has been shown over 2.5 years and continues to grow, and that's why, as Deputy Chief Judge Bolick mentioned, we're still hiring additional APJs simply because litigants are coming to the PTO as an alternative forum for the issue of patentability. So that's my perspective. That's what we see, really the whole spectrum of litigants and counsel focused on the issue of patentability.
Let me ask David, if you have a choice between a challenge in the district court or going before the PTAB, what factors do you consider in doing one or the other and why?
Sure. Again, thank you for inviting me in the opportunity. I think as Steve mentioned, there's no one-size-fits-all answer here. This has become a very popular forum, and I think those numbers tend to speak for themselves. But this is a one-issue forum. This is an invalidity forum. So if your case is quite strong in invalidity, or if you can develop a tactical plan to use the invalidity proceedings as a fulcrum into the litigation to box your opponent into favorable to you non-infringement positions, it's very attractive to look at the PTAB proceedings. And many people have beat a path to this door. So despite a bit of early questioning and nonetheless adoption by some first movers, it's become wildly popular. I think we were just looking at the most recent statistics on this, seeing that in the first half of fiscal year 2015, there have already been 85% of the institution decisions that we even got in fiscal year 14, which was a banner year over FY13 and before that 12. So the uptake is strong, and people are clearly making the decision that PTAB proceedings make sense for them and for their clients. Often when people are making that decision, when we're making that decision, we look for a strong invalidity case, one in which the aspects of this particular trial proceeding, namely a technically trained judiciary, typically there'll be at least one member on your panel that's pretty well aligned to the technology in the case. Sometimes you'll get lucky and have more, but there will typically be at least one very well aligned, and they will typically be the one you're interacting with in conference calls. So if we were looking for a good invalidity case that plays well to a judiciary that is informed on the subject matter of the case, that can include for us, frankly, invalidity positions based on 103 and multi-reference 103s that many times a district court litigator would look at and say, we've got to have a 102, we've got to have a novelty case in district court. We're not going to the jury with a four-reference combination. Now, having said that, in these PTAB trial proceedings, even the very first out-of-the-gate IPR, one, I believe, the Garmin-Kuzo case, that was a four-reference obviousness takedown of those claims. And I think that really surprised a lot of people that one could piece together before a tribunal that was able to understand the references in a sophisticated way how all the elements of the claimed inventions were there in the art and how a person of ordinary skill would put them together. So a good invalidity case, but frankly one that you may need a technically trained judiciary to vet. Those are good cases for the PTAB. You know, clearly there are other balancing or issues that tend to favor the PTAB as a invalidity venue. The standard review is certainly more favorable before the PTAB. The arguably the ambit given the claim, so the broadest reasonable interpretation aspects of claim construction tend to favor a challenger in those proceedings. So those are all good things. Add to that, I share the enthusiasm for cover business method review proceedings. Those are a very powerful aspect, and if your particular case can, I'm speaking largely from the perspective of a challenger here, because that's who makes the decision about whether to select this form. If the aspects of your particular patent that you're challenging can make it through the standing provisions of cover business method review, namely, can you establish that it's a cover business method patent, it involves financial products or services, it's not a technological invention, those sort of things. It's very attractive for the estoppel reasons, as pointed out, very narrow estoppel, and you do have, so only the issues actually raised, if that's not obvious to people, whereas in the other proceedings we're looking at actually raised or reasonably could have been raised. So that makes that proceeding a very attractive one to consider on your palette of options. And clearly there are cases in this day and age that involve 101, notwithstanding Judge Moore's point that those issues are, you know, well settled. I would say the same thing, in at least from the perspective of clients. And the CBM proceedings do give, again, a very focused review by a technically trained judiciary on those issues. On that point, I would probably say, from my perspective, I would prefer, though, to take a 101 case right now to the district court and try to dispose of it on 12B6, 12C at that point in the timeline, rather than take it to the Patent Trial and Appeal Board. I think we will start to see some of the more the decisions that tend to save that subject matter from a untimely death under 101. I think we will start to see those come out of the board, perhaps more quickly than we'll see them out of the district court. So that might skew the other way. If you're looking at primarily a 101 case, it might be right now district court might be the way to go.
You touched briefly on there being some differences in law between proceedings in the PTAB and those in the district court, and the audience will hear a lot more details about those today. But how do those differences impact the actual practice before the PTAB as opposed to the standards of substantive law in the district court? Can you elaborate?
Darren, I didn't quite get the question. Can you say again?
Sure. So you touched a bit about there being some substantive legal differences in the Patent Office standard for instituting. Burden of proof is obviously clear and convincing evidence in the district court and a different burden of proof in the PTAB. How does that impact the day-to-day practice before the PTAB for you?
Well, I mean, the burdens of proof, I think, as pointed out, who's to say whether 51% is really that much different than some arbitrary 75% number? I think it's hard to really quantify. On the other hand, being able to, as a patent challenger, come in with a claim construction position where sort of the tie goes to the runner framework would certainly be a broader interpretation standard, and being able to articulate a reason to distance oneself from narrower prosecution history inspired interpretations of claims is a very powerful
position from the get-go. And so I think it's more, to me, the claim construction advantages from a petitioner perspective of the Patent Trial and Appeal Board proceedings is the one that drives it more than the burdens, quite frankly.
Steve?
And just to add to that, I think, because David, you mentioned also the presumption of validity issue. I think that highlights the difference in fact finder and overall judge here. So although there are differences in the standard of proof as well, I think you're also, you have a different audience that's highlighted by that lack of presumption. You have trained judges who are within the office and take a different view of the questions they're presented than juries do. And to build on that obviousness point, I think you have judges who understand why a prior art reference that's about a complicated electronic system doesn't explain that the computer has a screen and a cord and it's encased in plastic. And so needing additional references or needing a person of skill to interpret something is something that I think is second nature, and you see the statistics that sort of double success rates at the PTAB for arguments on obviousness. And I think the other place that the legal differences in the rules we see play out is important is in discovery, and I think we'll touch on that more later in the panel too, but the notion that you need a threshold piece of evidence to get more, because it's a proceeding designed for efficiency and cost effectiveness and not to be different, intentionally different from district court proceedings, I think that that approach to questions like discovery is also a massively different mindset from litigation, and it is based on a legal principle that's stated in the way the board operates.
I think it's hard to really overstate the importance of the difference in the fact finder, the fact that you'll have someone with a technical background, with a background in IP law, making the validity decision. Then you go back even to the creation, as Dennis cited, of the central reexamination unit. And you look at cases where there were a lot of race conditions where you saw cases decided in the district court on the validity issue and simultaneously, or in some cases many years later, decided by the board. And you get a different result because of the different technical bent of the decision maker. I mean, the best example is probably the RIM case. You had this sort of angst-ridden story that the litigator was able to give to the jury about this guy in an airport and going to all the trouble to connect up and then just check his email, and then he found out, oh, he didn't have any email. And so the answer was push. And that got up to the central reexamination unit, and they did something very interesting. They read the claim. And the first decision that came out was, look, the word push is not found in this claim. And in fact, it's not in your specification. And so let's talk about the claim, which was very technical in nature. And it was a much more technical question, matching that up with the prior art, than, wow, push email is really cool, which I think they got away with at trial, frankly. And so I think the quality decision, when you talk about some sort of arbitrary standard like combining three or four references, you know, and that being sort of disqualifying you in court, it shouldn't disqualify you because sometimes, you know, the claims get very long and they have a lot of obvious things in them, and applying a number of references makes sense. I would note in the Garmin case, one of the interesting things is there were dependent claims that it was not instituted on and that were held to be valid. So I think there you got a really very fair decision, and that I think you can argue is technically supported by the art that was considered.
Especially in the life sciences space, you'll often have your validity argument where you're combining multiple references, three, four, five references. And it's always heavily technical, very specialized, very difficult for your average jury person to relate to. So I think having someone who is considering the validity of your claim, who's got the technical skills to really understand what's going on and put it into context and understand the law as well, that can't be overstated. Unlike the old style re-examinations, you know, you've got someone who's looking at it with fresh eyes from a technical perspective. I think that you've got an excellent shot at making those subtle arguments that maybe would be missed on a jury member or an examiner who had already had an entrenched position or who's coming at it from a you know, biased perspective.
Rose, let me ask you one other question. From the perspective of someone who represents patent owners, during patent trial and appeal board proceedings, there is an availability of an motion to amend. If the circumstances arise where a patent owner may want to narrow their claims, that practice has proven challenging empirically. What other considerations do patent owners go through in deciding to go down that route or other options available in the patent office? And maybe to start at the beginning, what are some of those other options?
Well, some of the other options are the ex parte re-exam proceedings, where you can basically file an ex parte re-examination on your own patent. You also have the option of filing a narrowing reissue. Usually, when you're dealing with cases in the life sciences space, they're pre-AIA. I haven't had any AIA cases come forward that have been subject to any of these proceedings that we now have available to us. It'll be interesting to see how those play out in the future, though, in the life sciences space. But you can proactively go in and amend your claims, place yourself in a better condition for dealing with either trial or IPR by taking advantage of some of these other procedures. Mm-hmm. Ideally, though, I advise my clients to maintain strategic continuations pending, and you have the ability to file as many continuations as you like off of your base case, claiming priority back, hopefully to a pre-AIA application, and you can adjust your claims on the fly, you know, to deal with whatever art might come up that you aren't aware of during one of these proceedings. Hopefully you've done a good job of prosecuting your applications, you've got a good handle on the art that's out there. More likely than not, maybe, you know, the key cases that are being applied against you, the prior art references or ones you're already familiar with, and they may throw another reference on top or, you know, argue for some different interpretation. But hopefully you're in a position where you can, you know, make some quick moves and work around anything that's thrown your way.
I think the thing I'd quickly add on that is timing is the key variable here. And in the pharma bio spaces, these tend to be earlier asserted in the life cycles. In the electronics and computer industries, a large portion of the patents that tend to be good fodder for these challenges are the ones that are asserted late in their life cycles. So, and sometimes clearly in the hierarchy of most attractive amendment fora, a strategic continuation is the most attractive option. For the ones that involve electronics, computers, and software, if they are very late in game, you may not have time to turn, and it's not going to be a... So I think one of the things that we may start seeing, the conventional wisdom up until very recently had been, don't bother, don't try, idle free is a slam dunk for the petitioner to shut down a patent owner's motion to amend for reasons that we may go into here a little bit more in a second. But I think we'll see that tide turning. There have been some... We've heard on the panel, and certainly the director's blog has suggested that the office is reacting to some of the very legitimate concerns raised amongst the patent owner community about the overreach of the board in shutting down motions to amend. And I think we will see more people embracing those because the time to get it to a new claim narrowed strategically to give advantage into your patent is short. The exit of these proceedings, if a motion to amend is granted, the claim is added, and you're off to the races, at least with it against others.
I'd like to mention that the rationale for the patent office taking the broadest reasonable construction of a claim, which is sort of that's the construction that the board takes. The rationale for that had been that there's no harm to the applicant because the applicant can always amend the claim and clarify it. that the claim is actually narrower. So you have this issue, if it's difficult to amend, you have the problem that a broad a construction which is actually wrong can invalidate a claim, and it's very difficult to remedy that. So that should be a consideration. And the other thing I would add, kind of from a strategy standpoint, is we talk about continuations and narrowing reissues and in trying to amend during the IPR, but ultimately the thing that's changed about patent practice is dependent claims are far more important than they used to be, because that's your opportunity to amend your pre-amend, if you would, have fallback positions. And I think one thing you are seeing starting with the referring even to the Garmin case, is that dependent claims will survive and will not be instituted for all the dependent claims. That's possible. And so that's a very important thing to actually, this way of practicing patent law that I think has been advocated sometimes of, okay, well, throw everything in the patent office and figure out what your invention is later. No. It's not a good idea anymore. You should understand what you think your invention is, and you should have clearly delineated fallback positions, because the sort of throw it in there and figure out what it is later on, I think is something that just does not work like it used to.
If I could just throw in some slightly contrarian views on a couple of these points. Just on BRI, just to note that another justification the office has given is that the AIA allows coordination across office proceedings, so things like reexamination and other office proceedings can be coordinated. They have a BRI standard. And in addition to the ability to amend, think about the inconsistency of trying to work with those conflicting claim construction standards at the same time. I know that's been advanced as well. And just on the amendment side, I know I've been hearing from the board, we've been seeing in reasoning from the board, they're being very active in giving guidance about what they want. It's not just in the context of amendment. If you listen to the board on a call, they'll tell you what you need to show to get the relief you seek. And I know it's been a pretty small number of successful applicants for amendment, but I also know the board has been striving to find examples where they can, I think, point to a properly supported motion that would enable amendment. So even without maybe rule changes, I think we'll be seeing, as the panel is suggesting, more successful amendments in the future. And we've seen guidance certainly about using alternative routes like re-exam, reissue. The board will tell you this isn't the place to get 30 claims added to your patent.
Judge Chen?
Yes, definitely appreciate all the commentary. Speaking for myself and certainly the leaders at the board, Deputy Chief Judge Bullock and Chief Judge Smith, have stated their gratification on the outcome at the Federal Circuit in the Cruzo case on broadest reasonable interpretation. As far as motions to amend are concerned, again, starting with Idle Free, and then about a year ago in the Toyota decision, and then last fall in the Corning decision, we at the PTAB feel that we're trying to do our best to lay out in those sort of representative decisions what it takes to be successful on a motion to amend. Now, for whatever reason, the numbers haven't yet portrayed that, but if on a motion to amend you've got a reasonable number of substitute claims, you've given us a proposed construction for the new terms that you're adding, in addition you're pointing to the written description support in the specification, and then most importantly you're showing the patentability of your proposed substitute claim over and above not just the prior art of record, but the art of which you as patent owner are aware of. And Chief Judge Smith was quoted at an event last month, and certainly speaking purely from my personal standpoint, I echo his comments. I agree with him when he said, on its face, for a patent owner to attempt to do that, go through that checklist, and most importantly, show the patentability, it on its face does not appear to be as difficult as the numbers are thus far showing. So. I think there is certainly commentary that has come in. Deputy Chief Judge Bullock alluded to it. There will be a quick fix in terms of the page, the pages on the motion to amend, and there may be other things in the future. But obviously, it's something that the PTAB is looking at carefully. because the motion to amend was viewed as an important part of this entire process, and we'll just have to see how that plays out going forward.
Judge Chen, let me ask you one other question. A lot of the panelists mentioned one of the considerations they have in mind when choosing to file before the PTAB is the technical fluency of the decision makers. In practice, how do you see that coming up, if ever, in your interaction with other panelists?
Yes, thank you. So recall that under Section 6 of Title 35, at the PTAB, all matters are heard by a three-judge panel. So that's presumptively what you are going to have. That's quite a contrast from other trial court tribunals involving patents and intellectual property, where you've got a single Article III judge, a single magistrate judge, or a single ALJ at the ITC. So these three-judge panels are typically comprised of judges who have been patent attorneys. I think virtually everybody at the PTAB is registered to practice. Beyond that, there are technical backgrounds ranging from engineering, electrical, computer, to life sciences. What's really impressed me is the level of scientific training. So there are quite a number, and by that I mean several dozen at least, PhDs up and down the hallways at the PTAB in physics, electrical engineering, biochemistry. So those of us like me with a tiny little master's degree, we feel a little bit intimidated by the incredible scientific knowledge of our colleagues. Now, where that comes to bear is that typically a panel will, as counsel have noted, comprise three, of which at least one, and sometimes two, and sometimes all three, have had either the training or experience in practice or experience inside a company where they've been managing patent portfolios on that subject matter. So so many of my colleagues have, such as myself, practiced at firms or been inside companies or have been examiners at the agency, that they bring quite a wealth of background. So I think all of that redounds to the benefit of the parties, the petitioner and the patent owner, to have a three-judge panel with quite a bit of scientific background.
So proceedings before the Patent Trial and Appeal Board are, of course, by and large on their papers. And the rules applicable for PTAB proceedings place limits on what discovery the parties can get as a matter of right and require them to request additional discovery. And this takes place against a backdrop of a statutorily mandated time frame for the proceeding to complete. How do those differences impact how parties can develop their case and present evidence for their clients' positions? Steve, do you have thoughts to start?
Sure. I guess I'd suggest that it, and if you look at the rules, you realize that you have to develop your case in advance. If you're the petitioner, the day you file is the day you make your opening statement and present all your evidence. So you need to be ready. And I think everything that happens from that moment forward reflects the fact that this is a streamlined, efficient proceeding that has a timeline on it. So when you're asking for relief from the board, when you're asking for discovery, when you're trying to change the schedule, whatever you're trying to do, I think you need to realize that that argument or that request is being made against the backdrop of what the proceeding is. And I'm sure the panel would have lots of experiences with these kinds of calls, but that theme comes up over and over again throughout the proceeding. And while there is the oral hearing at the end, which helps you pull together all the material, I do think the premium on careful, thorough, deep preparation on paper at the outset is really the key if you're the petitioner to succeeding. And then on the owner's side, finding the gaps in that initial case and doing all this against the background of a one-year timeline plus the 6 months at the front is really where the nature of the proceeding takes you in a different direction than a district court.
Yeah, I think that's another point that can't be underemphasized, the importance of having every single duck in a row at the petition filing stage. That's with respect to every dependent claim that you need to challenge, your client needs to challenge, with respect to all the evidence, all the glue logic of your arguments to combine the references, any interpretational issues need to be in the record. As petitioner, that petition is your opening brief, and on the rules, your only other opportunity will be in reply, and should, strictly speaking, be limited to arguments raised in the patent owner's response. So it's all got to be there.
From the standpoint,
go ahead. I was going to say, quickly on the discovery issue, I think this is largely a thing that I think disadvantages the patent owner more than the petitioner, because again, the petitioner is laying, as long as the petitioner lays out his entire case in advance, they're on invalidity on the papers, patents in print and publications, there really aren't many discovery issues which inform here. On the patent owner side, perhaps secondary considerations, you're very hamstrung in getting those. And the other big thing for a patent owner is the guy that just filed the petition against me, is that the real party in interest? Is that the privy? Is that the party that needs to be bound to the outcome and the estoppels here? Or is that the party, is that party acting for another party, in essence, privy or a party in interest, who would themselves be barred from filing this petition under some of the timing provisions, the 315 bars or DJ bars or things of that sort. So discovery, very limited, and we'll get to it probably some more, but that really falls strongly against the patent owner. I'm sorry, go ahead.
Yes, from the standpoint of the patent owner, I think this is one of the main differences between re-exam and IPR. I mean, the conventional wisdom re-exam was actually not to file preliminary response because you gave the petitioner a chance to respond again. But when you say sort of 18-month timeline, there's really a 3-month timeline as the patent owner because the preliminary response is absolutely key. I mean, once it's instituted, you've got an uphill battle. And so that is the preliminary response is going to very often drive the result for the patent owner.
Agreed.
In a district court proceeding, often you think the most important witnesses are your inventor and a technical expert. The inventor is very rarely going to make a show in a PTAB proceeding, but there will be expert declarations often from both parties. How do the role of experts differ in proceedings before the PTAB?
I guess I'll talk. So, as I mentioned, experts are, as a petitioner, your experts are your glue logic. Your experts are there to make the factual positions, that the evidentiary positions that you need in your case, and also from the patent owner perspective, that you can't find in the documentary record. So that's what they are about. In these proceedings, unlike district court litigation, there's generally not live testimony. There's been one instance that I know of live testimony, and there are some very particular reasons why that came up. But you should assume no live testimony from your expert. Your expert is declaring on the papers. And because of that, and in some ways because of the nature of the issues before the tribunal, this is not a beauty contest about how poised the expert is on the stand, how professorial they are, how heavily credentialed they are. In addition, I think there's less of a gulf between the technical expertise of the expert and that of the trier of fact here. So a lot of this being super impressed, I don't understand what he said, but he said it, he's an expert, I'll go with it, aspects really don't play out as much in the PTAB proceedings as they would in district court. So those are a couple things that I would note.
And I would just throw on the table, I think Absolutely, David's point about, I think, jury relatability is not an issue necessarily at the PTAB, although if you think about it, if that deposition is videotaped, it could get play in the litigation. And we do see, I think, credibility as the foundational issue for experts. The board actively makes credibility determinations. We credit expert A, we discredit expert B in final written decisions. That will obviously have impacts on Federal Circuit review of those decisions. And I think the credibility issue actually is the occasional wedge to get in video testimony. There have been a couple occasions where the board has allowed very carefully limited quantities of videotaped deposition excerpts to be put into the record to show credibility issues. But I think absolutely it's a different game unless you have the same expert in both places, in which case you have to be triply careful.
Judge Chen, do you often find yourself looking at the potential credibility differences between expert witnesses? And how do you view experts in understanding the technology, given all of the PhDs around the PTAB?
Yes, well, notwithstanding what I said about the scientific qualifications of any particular panel, we absolutely welcome the input of experts. And again, speaking personally, I have found very effective some declarations submitted by expert witnesses which spend several pages with an overview of the exact particular technology that's involved in the claims. Because while we have all worked in technology or in life sciences and have familiarity with the general concepts, this particular invention, what is being claimed, what is being challenged, what's at issue here in this dispute? I mean, this is a lawsuit, for God's sake. So this is very important. It's good if the expert can lead us a bit and remind us of the specific technology as well as the background, what the prior art was or was not at the time of the invention. So absolutely, that's been, at least to me, and I assume to most of my colleagues, a very high utility. So the petitioner, as has been alluded to, gets to come in with a petition and an expert declaration. The patent owner typically will wait until after institution, if there is institution, to the time of the formal response to respond. But certainly, yes, the experts provide very valuable information. As far as a credibility battle, again, as counsel have alluded to, there have been very few, in other words, I think one instance where there has been live testimony. There has not been live testimony in the traditional battle of the experts in front of the jury. So that type of thing, I believe, is going to get a lot less airtime with the PTAB simply because, again, it's a situation where there is no lay jury. We do have some familiarity with the scientific background, and the experts are there to help us and guide us through and really help point out what's either present in the references that discloses, teaches, or suggests the limitations that are being challenged, or from the other perspective, what's not.
One of the rationales was articulated by Congress when enacting the provisions of the AIA, which established the PTAB, was these provisions would be faster, they would be much less expensive than challenging validity in a district court. But I hear you saying we've got to spend a lot of work to front load and prepare our petition for a patent owner. I need to have it all sorted out by the time I file my preliminary response, and I still need to go through all the work in preparing an expert and having him or her submit a declaration. So are these proceedings really faster and cheaper than challenging validity in a district court?
Before counsel speak, I will say simply from my perspective as the administrative patent judge trier of fact, yes, they're very fast and they don't seem to be slowing down, so.
Well, let me start, I guess, with Rose and Lee. You know, what are kind of the real expenses, costs that you would advise your client if they're considering going down these routes?
Usually IPRs are considered as part of an overall litigation strategy, so they're an add-on, they aren't a substitute. And a lot of the work you put in, you know, in either defending or prosecuting an IPR, that's going to serve you well later on in the trial. So I don't see it as a cost-saving measure for my clients, at least. It's more something you can do to help better position yourself for a favorable outcome.
I'll just say from my experience, you know, our firm, we're a patent prosecution firm, so we would do re-exams on our own, but we work with the litigator to do IPRs. I mean, I think it's litigation, and I think it's actually closer to litigating before the ITC than it is to litigating in district court. So given the timeline, given the complexity, you know, I think it's the province of litigators, and we're doing those with litigators. We're not doing those on our own, and I don't think that, you know, a person focusing on patent prosecution, trying to keep up with the startup clients in Silicon Valley and trying to also manage one of these trials is feasible.
And I think you have a lot of folks who specialize in this area now, and they're sort of like a bridge between the patent prosecutors and the litigation team. So it's you've basically added a new set of practitioners to your team.
This also may be a your mileage may vary sort of response in the sense of we and a number of people here certainly handle many matters where this is going to go all the way through final written decisions, appeal strategies, and like, and very much so, and that's probably very characteristic of many of the biotech cases. In those, this is not a quick get out and we stayed the district court case, we didn't expend funds there, and that crappy patent is invalid and I don't have to worry about it anymore. That's not how this works out. Now, I think in the tech sector, there certainly are clients for whom that is the view of these proceedings, and it has worked out quite well for some that have been able to challenge a patent that was perhaps not so firmly grounded either from a prior art sustainability perspective or a 101 perspective, and early out of these decisions. It is a significant cost savings because a cancellation of all the claims that are asserted against you at, say, T plus 12 or 16 cuts off all the remainder of costs. And the suit, the dynamics of the suit in that, those spaces can often be a little bit more of the settlement value litigations. So for those ones, I think the costs aspects, there's a solid rationale from a cost perspective, and I think the statistics show a large number of very early in process settlements. I think the PTO publishes statistics, and it's an astounding number of these cases which settle, which is one of the distinguishing features of these proceedings when contrasted with the earlier generational proceedings, the re-ex practices. These are proceedings that parties can come to an agreement and settle and be done.
And I think David's answer is right. I mean, I think it depends. First, the costs relative to litigation. I think the cost of an IPR or PTAB proceeding, if you take it separately, are a fraction of sometimes a busy month of discovery in district court litigation. I mean, it all depends. And I think the dynamic of cases driven by cost threat, so PAE cases, some other cases, there really can be a dramatic difference of being able to, especially if you can stay the case. And then you really are at this much lower budget level, and you have a much smaller number you can talk about being the cost that you're being threatened with as a defendant. On the team question, I think that's another a big question about where the costs are. And so I think I'd agree with the comments that it's a really different form. If you ask a litigator what's required for the PTAB litigation skills, if you ask a prosecutor, sometimes not the group here, but some prosecutors will say you'll need prosecution skills, or it's just like interference, or it's just like this. And I think it's really, over the last 2.5 years, shown it to be something entirely different, or at least a hybrid of those things. And so if you can have a litigation team that is qualified to appear without the pro hoc vice risk about whether you'll get that team in front of the board, and they understand both what's similar to and different from litigation. For example, you can't argue at the final hearing for 2 hours your trial themes. You can see people do that. You can go and attend some hearings, and you'll see some really good litigators go in and try to argue themes for 2 hours with the board. But it's a different process. And so if you can get a team that is able to do both or bridges both, however you compose the team, I think that hybrid skill set can reduce the overall cost. And in cases where it's going to go the distance, as David was saying, and Rose was saying, it gives you that extra insurance policy that may absolutely be worth the incremental investment of running both proceedings together.
Judge Chen, picking up on Steve's comment about the hybrid nature of these proceedings, what do you look for, or how would you tell a well-presented case, both from the side of the challenger and the patent owner?
Yes, well, thank you. And following up on that comment, I think I have seen personally excellent presentations from large law firms headed by people who I think would style themselves as district court trial lawyers. At the same time, I've seen equally excellent presentations from what would be styled as your traditional patent boutique with more of a prosecution background. So for me anyway, as the trier of fact, we're all very early on in this, but for me so far, it's not one size fits all. And the common theme through the best presentations that I've seen on paper is really attention to detail and avoidance of conclusory statements in the lawyer's argument, which are then cited to an equally conclusory statement in the expert declaration. So really what we on the board appreciate most, at least again speaking personally, is just the detail. So just as if you were arguing a case on appeal and you have a pin site, and that's critical, where in this case does the precedential statement occur? Well, where exactly in this reference is the disclosure or the teaching or suggestion of the challenge limitation? Tell me which figure. Tell me which column. We have had a number of cases where the panel in reviewing the spec and the figures will happen upon something that is probative on claim construction, and then we spend time trying to see if either party or their experts had cited to it. So I guess my admonition would be absolutely job one is to know the challenged claims and the challenged patent cold, because the panel, the three judges on the panel, will certainly do their part to have that well within their bounds. And then, again, the attention to detail in making the presentation. We are well aware of the page limits and the constraints. 60 pages sounds like a lot until you're challenging 15 or 20 claims on several grounds, and then it gets to be difficult. 80 pages on a CBM sounds like a lot, but again, with a number of grounds and claims, that gets to be difficult. So we are sympathetic to that, but given those page limit constraints, that would be my best advice, to really pay attention to the detail. And we've seen situations where the exact same block quote is utilized over and over again, and sometimes that's applicable, but sometimes it's not. And you get to a dependent claim, and counsel have alluded to the increasing importance of dependent claims. And if we see the same block quote to the same figure, and we're supposed to try to figure out why it is that the same citation, conclusory citation, applies to the dependent claim as it did to the independent. So that's where I think the detail comes in. A special note with respect to the patent owner, and this gets to preliminary responses. I think we are seeing a slight uptick in the number of preliminary responses. From my personal perspective, that's a good thing. I think at the outset there might have been 75% to 80%. Now we're maybe 85% to 90%. But still, I am seeing preliminary responses that are 5 pages long, 10 pages long. You get 60 pages, and there are many things that a patent owner can do in those 60 pages, both the sort of technical arguments on 315, 325, same arguments or art presented previously, claim construction, and then the heart of the matter. Do the references cited by the petitioner disclose, teach, or suggest the limitations that are being challenged? And I'm still, I guess, personally surprised at how many patent owners are not utilizing those 60 pages to the fullest extent on the range of arguments that are available. So that's where I'm coming from as far as what the patent owner might do to take advantage of that preliminary response.
David, what is your list of the short list of the best practices for someone presenting a case before the Patent Trial and Appeal Board?
Well, following the points made by Judge Chen, I think it's a details game. It's not thinking this is a thematic. I think it's methodically unloading each of the limitations of the claim, and from a petitioner perspective, establishing where in the art it's taught. If it's for multiple references, why one would be informed by this reference and combined with another reference. You've got to do all the blocking and tackling. So that's point number one. Flipping that to the patent owner side, and I agree that many practitioners will typically miss great opportunities in the preliminary response to winnow down the case, to tailor the case, to steer the case, frankly, where the petitioner would not like it to be instituted in. It's the same game, but it's the reverse or the obverse. It's what are the weaknesses in the case? And you're pointing to the weaknesses. Your big win at the preliminary response stage is you may not get the entire case non-instituted, although there are plenty of hand-waving petitions out there that you can get a non-institution decision across the board. But if you can point out the defects on seven of the claims, some of the key dependent claims, that is a huge strategic win for you. So I guess the thematic answer to the question of thematics aren't the thing to focus on is it's the details.
Yeah, we heard earlier on the panel that there are a number of cases working their way up from the board to the Federal Circuit. The commissioner has noted that there may be some changes to the rules in front of the Patent Trial and Appeal Board, and there's legislative efforts to perhaps refine the process now. Looking forward, how do you see practice before the Patent Trial and Appeal Board changing over the next few years? Let me just go down the panel and start with you, Steve.
Sure. Well, I guess, I think some of the early reactions we got around this time last year when more early decisions were coming in were based on very small numbers. And I think we'll continue to see things like the success rate, especially if you measure it correctly, for challenges normalizing a little more. So the death squad comments, I think, that echo has stopped ringing in the hall a little bit. And people are understanding that it's a sophisticated process that requires some thought. But you can succeed as either petitioner or patent owner. And you'll see more success on the institution front and on the motions to amend, is my prediction, for patent owners, and some more normalizing there. I think you'll continue to see the board trying to be very responsible as a steward of its time as it becomes fully loaded. So, we've crossed 3,000 petitions now, and the new normal at the board is a very, very busy board. And so I think you'll see over the next year the board continuing to look at appropriate ways of dealing with that 325, other ways of being careful and insisting on detail. And I think if we remember who the audience is for these proceedings, it's its power and its danger for a party. You have to explain everything very carefully, and I think the board will continue to lack patience where they think a standing argument, a qualification argument, an amendment argument is not fully explained. Motivations to combine, especially, I think will continue to be a place the board focuses as it's trying to decide where to spend its resources. And then you'll see continued activity up at the outside the PTAB reacting to what's happening as the pipeline moves on to the next stage, either at the appeal level. And I think it'll be interesting to see how often we see Rule 36 in play because docket management, I know Judge Moore was not concerned, but I think there is a lot moving toward the Federal Circuit. So it'll be interesting to see how many decisions end up with written decisions as opposed to Rule 36. And then the estoppel question as it plays back out at the district court and at the board. We've actually seen now a central district case that people have been spending some time talking about from Judge Bernal. There's an IPR case that has worked its way back into the board where we're starting to see data points on what it means to be estopped. And I think those questions are going to affect the front end as well as what happens to this big wave of cases working through the first time, the back end. And on estoppel, just a plug here, I think it's sometimes the biggest elephant in the room when you're talking about one of these proceedings. You know, if it's not CBM where I have more limited estoppel, am I willing to take on the estoppel of IPR? What about PGR? And I think one of the questions people have been asking themselves is, well, what does estoppel really mean? I'm going to be estopped somewhere. Do I want to be estopped by what happens at the district court where I'm sandwiched in between other proceedings, maybe drug sentencings? Or on validity, do I want to take estoppel at the board? And I think the numbers coming out and people digging deeper into those over the next year will, I think, help parties who have been holding back. I'm not sure we want to increase the load for the board, but I think you may see even more people deciding this is the place to bring this kind of dispute. So that's my 2 cents for the next year.
Judge Chen, how do you see the practice evolving over the next few years?
Sure, thank you. So I guess I have two comments, one very general and big picture. Internally at the board, I think we're going to keep going as well as we can with the volume of filings as that starts to bump up against the deadlines for final decisions on last year's filings. So we're going to do our best to manage the workload. I predict that the board as a whole and the individual panels will become perhaps more efficient and even more expedited on some of the discovery and technical procedural issues that are coming up in these conference calls that occur multiple times a day on different cases. Hardly a week goes by without some issue of almost first impression on a procedural twist as we're all working through the rules and the trial practice guide. From a more specific standpoint, something that we haven't talked a lot about this morning is the oral hearing. So these AIA trials begin with institution, and the trial lasts 12, 16 months. So it's different from your district court or ITC trial. But we do have a hearing. We have a live hearing where counsel come in and they get to argue for a certain period of time. And for me anyway, in my limited experience, I've participated in hearings live in the hearing room in Alexandria. I've done it remotely. It's one of my favorite parts of being on the PTAB. It's one of those moments where there's give and take and back and forth, and we are asking questions of counsel and they're trying to respond. But my particular prediction is that over the next year or two, those hearings will be better accommodated by all. And by that I mean the following. As those of you who have done hearings are well aware, because the PTAB is a widely dispersed tribunal, nothing else like it really, with judges all across all three time zones, the chances are that when you walk into that hearing room in Alexandria, there will be a monitor on the wall and one of your three judges will be visual to you only in that way. Now, what does that mean for me as the remote judge? I am staring at a screen. The screen is pointed directly at the center of the podium. I do not see what's on the wall as far as you're clicking through your slide deck. There are no microphones at counsel table, so the tiniest little things can make a huge difference in how that hearing progresses from the perspective of a remote judge such as myself. What does that mean? Please speak at the podium, not at counsel table when you're raising objections or responding. Please refer to exhibits slides by number as you're going through them. And I think some of you may have found that in some of these hearings, we may have multiple remote judges. Two of the three may well be remote, and there may be one live body with you in Alexandria. So this is going to be part and parcel of the PTAB experience just because of the dispersion of the judges and how the cases have been assigned. It may be the rarity that you show up for your hearing in Alexandria and actually see all three judges before you. So that's a very practical thing because the transcript is a critical part of what we review in assembling the final decision. So those are just a couple of pointers to keep in mind as you go to the oral hearing to make it a better experience during the hearing and then afterwards for the panel.
David, what changes are you looking forward to?
Question again?
What changes are on your radar?
Okay, so I want to reinforce the point first that I've never had a hearing that didn't have a remote judge, so it happens all the time. You need to plan for it. In terms of change, I think we're going to see a bit of a consolidation in
councils. I think we've now gotten to the point where there are there's a substantial trial, patent trial and appeal board trial bar that's very experienced in these proceedings. And I think clients are tending to gravitate towards those levels of experience. I think several of us have alluded to the motion to amend. I think that's going to be a very huge game changer. From the perspective of the PTAB, they present very serious timing challenges. They introduce at a late stage of the process a whole perturbation that throws the case into disarray, and the rules don't really deal very well with how the merits of an amendment can be vetted. So it's sort of way too late, and there's not time in the schedule for it. So the board has been, I think, largely finding reasons not to entertain motions to amend because of the challenges they present. That said, my view is that it is inevitable that the the shall clauses of the statute be given some ambit here, and that motions to amend will become a substantial part of the practice from the patent owner's perspective. That will radically change the dynamic in these proceedings. So that I guess resonate with. I think the people often refer to it in terms of the claim kill rates. I think the kill rates will tend to fall. We've had a self-selection, maybe not entirely self-selection, but of weak cases, weak patents that have come before the board in the initial samples. The very high kill rates have certainly encouraged many other players to join the party. And I think there is a perception that you can't lose at the PTAB. The death panel, Judge Rader's comments on death panels certainly reinforced that and made the news. That bubble, I think, is working its way out, together with the fact that patent owners are getting more sophisticated. And there is a much more sophisticated patent owner counsel portion of the trial bar as well, that know the weakness points to push back. I mentioned it at preliminary response stage. So I think we will see a much more balanced set of outcomes, and I know the patent office itself, the director has been making those comments, and I think those will play out. So we'll see more balance. Motions to amend will be big, and I think we'll see some consolidation in the trial bar.
I think it'll be interesting to see how a post-grant review goes in terms of challenging validity of patents on like 101 grounds, 112 grounds, or even a validity challenge based on the non-publication of prior art. So how enthusiastically those grounds are taken up for challenging patents, it'll be interesting to see.
I would echo your comments about sort of the kill rate, as you put it. I think that there is definitely adverse selection, and the low-hanging fruit goes first. I'm interested in Dennis's comment that as many half of patents might have invalid claims. I think that I would say that a little more precisely, maybe half of patents that ever get litigated. There's sort of this large amount of dark matter of patents. You know, probably 90% of patents are never litigated or asserted, and it's probably a much higher percentage of those are valid because, as Justice Kagan pointed out recently in Cisco case, validity and infringement are sort of two sides of the same coin. So I think that really the kill rate is actually not very different if you look in the business method area in the patent office for original patent applications. I mean, the kill rate there is very, very high as well. You would expect as a transitional period where the standard has changed and patent applicants are adjusting and putting a higher standard on what they'll file. I guess in my practice, we've been sort of referring out sort of business method e-commerce patents for a long time, But now I feel bad about passing them on. I sort of have a budding pro bono practice and talking to people for a half hour and explaining why not to waste their time. it surprises me that investors still sort of send them my way, and I guess if there are VCs out here doing that, I'd say thanks for thinking of me, but please cut it out. I think that you will see as quality, you know, the goal of this whole, of the PTAB being created is increasing quality, and I think that's ultimately what's happening.
So before I thank the panel,
Darren, if I may, and not wishing to prolong this as we're, I think, well into the lunch hour, but I just want to say, speaking personally, and I assume for the great majority, if not all of my colleagues, the two words that I've heard in the last 5 minutes, death and kill, they are never uttered at the PTAB. That is not, I mean, that is not what the PTAB sees itself about in any way, shape, or form. I can't be more unequivocal or categorical about that. We are a tribunal that has a mission statement of adjudicating patentability of issued claims. And the results are what they are so far, and we're very early on in this legislation. Time will tell how things turn out, and in the meantime, it'll be a great ride for all of us. So.
Any questions from the audience before? Yep.
One of the hearings that I looked at, trying to put a decision, the PTAB board, in fact, said this response is not really well articulated, and it's not our job to come up with arguments for you, the patent owner. And that was actually in the opinion. It's not our job to come up with arguments for the patent owner. And so the claims are canceled. Is that really?
Well, I'm not aware of that specific language, but certainly as set forth in the Act itself and in the rules and in the trial practice guide, it's incumbent on both parties to come to us with their arguments. And again, speaking purely from a personal perspective, I'm a co-inventor, a named co-inventor on two U.S. patents. It was a great moment of pride for me when I learned that the patent had been issued by the agency. So I feel that I personally at least can stand partly in the shoes of the inventor and perhaps the patent owner. And so from my perspective, if I'm the owner of this intangible intellectual property right and it's being challenged in a tribunal that has the power to cancel those claims, if it were me, and if I had enough pennies in my piggy bank, I would absolutely do whatever it took to present every argument possible to ensure that the challenge claims emerge through the process as intact as possible. So that is really incumbent on the parties, and I think, without quoting your language, the panel is certainly not charged with coming up with different, better, worse, other arguments for the parties. The parties get their page limit, they get to have claim charts, they have their experts, and they're able to present the arguments, and certainly there is case law from appellate courts relating to patent practice, not just PTAB, but otherwise as far as what the trier of fact is compelled to do on those situations. Well, I think 325D is an important provision. As you say, it is a part of docket management. Now, I personally have not been on any panels where we sua sponte raise that issue. Again, following on that gentleman's question, the panels I've been on, what the parties come to us is what is viewed, certainly at the institution stage. That could be, and I think there were some comments to that effect on the request for comment about whether whether there should be more latitude in that regard as far as, you know, expediting the overall process by allowing things to occur sua sponte. But in general, the panels that I've been on and what I've been aware of, there has not been a lot of sua sponte anything by the panels regarding new arguments, raising technical arguments, 315, 325, that type of thing.
In the interest of letting folks get to lunch, let me thank the panel for their thoughtful comments.